Hey folks, welcome back to our Planet Zoo North American build using the brand new pack. And as promised in the last video, which was a little bit low key, things are gonna get a little bit weirder. It's about bloody time. It took a whole video for us to get here. So what we're going to do is build a church and a graveyard and a mausoleum, and it's haunted, and that's about it, I guess. And it's going to be a marshy sort of area, which is where moose, or meese, as they shall now be called, of course, where the meese quite like to live. They live in these marshy sort of wetland, low wetlands. Not like sopping wet, which is a horrible term, but like a little bit wet, you know? Anyway, so that's the whole idea. Again, based on a real world image, this church I found in Oregon, this like abandoned church in the wilderness. I apologize if the fact it's a church annoys some people. It's really not the intention. The idea is simply that, you know, abandoned churches in the wilderness are cool. that's as far as it goes. There's really no commentary beyond that. So we're gonna build it, and then we're gonna do some cool stuff with it. So all I'm doing here is building a steeple sort of area. Thought I'd cheat my way up through, but it didn't really work, so we are gonna have to handcraft it with a little bit of wood. Not a problem when I figure out how to rotate the bloody wood. Really just bending that into the correct shape, duplicate it along, colour it in, flip it around. It's definitely not the neatest thing in the world, but you're not going to see it up close, so it doesn't matter as far as I'm concerned. As long as it looks good from the front, that is what matters. And there we go, little steeple. And I built a little cross as well. This was my own invention. The cross was not there on the actual church. I just thought I'd chuck it in there. It looks really good, like against the night sky. You kind of catch it against the moon. It looks very dramatic. Anyways, the idea is this is the graveyard on the outskirts of town. You know, you're not quite into the proper town yet. We'll be getting there in a couple of videos. On episode 4 in particular is where the sort of the town starts. This is the outskirts, but over time it's just been a bit neglected. It's been left behind, and they thought, you know what, let's turn it into a haunted attraction. Which you could suggest is disrespectful, but at the end of the day, it's Planet Zoo. And it's a video game, so it doesn't actually matter. On we go. So yeah, just doing some detail work on the zoo, putting some cladding around the outside. Stuff like that, lots of wood, lots and lots of Arctic wood. Which some people suggested was, like, originally this area was first settled by the Vikings, and that's why there's all this sort of Arctic, Nordic sort of architecture lying around and being used, which I quite like as an idea. That's even a better justification, you know. Although, why would the church be like that? I don't know, but we'll figure it out. Either way, one of my main problems was I wanted to build a building out of the logs just because it's the right texture for what I was trying to do, but the problem is, of course, then the windows weren't quite correct. They should be more vertical rather than horizontal. This is about the point where I stopped looking at my image, basically, and started just doing my own thing. I had a very specific idea in mind, however, which you will see come to life very soon. As we just, again, I just didn't want the building to feel very basic, so I just, you know, add some wood. You can have the log exterior, the basic log exterior, that's fine. At the end of the day, you're not going to see 99% of this building by the time I'm bloody done, but it's important to layer your own stuff over the top of it just to, you know, give it a little bit more personality, a little bit more individuality, I would suggest. So building some window frames, stuff like that. It'd be really nice if there was better windows in this game. We need, like, vertical windows. We need a way to, like, punch holes in things, I think. Anyway, this is going to sit as sort of the back of the habitat. And those are my, I think I get rid of those. Yeah, there we go. This is going to sit at the back of the habitat, and then there's going to be a graveyard, then there's going to be a mausoleum, and there's going to be tons of foliage. So much foliage work done. And about half the habitat is foliage work. It ends up looking really cool. Very dramatic at nighttime, as you will see pretty soon. Big chunky front door there. What I like to think in my head, because this is Arctic architecture, it's Nordic, but it's a Christian church, clearly. And that would not be a combination that would naturally work out. So, my theory is maybe back in ye olden times, when the Nords were here and the Christians were here and they're kind of sort of battling for this land, which should probably just been left to the Native Americans in the first place, but that's neither here nor there. As a sign of goodwill to the Christians and like as a peace offering, the Nords built them a church. And that's why it's used Nordic methods, and there's rune carvings, and it's stuff that they would have done themselves, but it's a Christian building. There we go, justified. But of course, it's Halloween, it has to glow. I had a very, if you remember back to my aquatic park build, and we did a crocodile habitat, which is like a crocodile tunnel under the water, and it was by like a witch's cabin sort of thing in the woods. Same kind of idea. I wanted you to feel like there's something nefarious going on inside this building, and this green light is flooding dramatically out from every orifice. You're never going to see inside, but there's something going on in there. And I really wanted, you can see it every now and again where you catch it, where the shadow is apparent between each beam. I wanted each beam of light to feel important and strong and noticeable all on its lonesome. And it worked out really well in the end. Gonna stick that on and get rid of it very quickly. There's so much ivy on this thing, but it's meant to, you know, the ground is swallowing it back up. It's returning to the earth from whence it came. It's the general idea. So yeah, you're gonna see a lot of these ivy patches. Basically, I like that justification actually. Maybe I can have like an angry Nordic god come back and kill everyone at the end. Anyways, on we go. Yeah, just really wanted to feel abandoned and broken down and lost to the ages, basically. We can say, to kind of justify this a little bit more, maybe there's a... got it. Sorry, I just slapped. That probably wasn't a nice noise. Right. Because the beaver... Right, this is good. Because the beavers built the dam, right, and that's caused this whole area to flood, as we talked about in the last video, beavers build their dams, and what happens is that causes the water flow to change, and some areas become like low-lying wetlands. That happens all the time, and it's really good for the meese. So, and this is linked with that last exhibit, it's in the same area, I did that very much on purpose. So, as this area flooded with the water that we'll be adding in a little bit, it caused problems. It started to leak into the coffins, you know, bodies started to float up and stuff like that. The ground was becoming very soft, and it was going to ruin the graves. That makes a lot of sense. So, in order to keep that memory alive and to honour the people buried here, everyone was moved, which, you know, people don't want to dig up a grave, but it's better than it all going to hell. It's kind of a pun there. So the people in the graves were moved away to a nice new safe dig site, and this place was fully abandoned. No corpses whatsoever. No people buried here is a nicer word than corpses. Nobody's buried here whatsoever. Look at that light. Isn't that sexy? There will be a lot more work on making that look perfect. I couldn't light the cross up, though, and make it look good. And it's not meant to be, you know, lit up by lights. It's meant to be lit up by crazy magic. So I decided to eventually just leave it unlit. But I bloody tried. I tell you, as you can see, there's a lot of experimentation going on here to try and make it look good. It always looked, I don't know, it drew attention away from the bottom, which I was really happy with. You can see how it's got the shafts coming out. I love a good shaft coming out. And it didn't work. So this was the other idea. Now I scrapped this very quickly. But the idea was this chasm opening up around the base of the church, and then that's also spilling forth with the same sort of light, which I went a little crazy with, as you can see, but it's just too much. And I tried some other methods. I tried like smaller lights, you know, just the spotlights. And again, it's doing what I just talked about, where it's pulling focus away from the church, which I want to really stand out as this main source of light. So I just got rid of all that. Now it's time to build a graveyard. I'm very happy about that justification. We've got a whole story here about the Nords and the Christians and them giving them this church as a gift. And then, you know, Christians of the time obviously buried their dead here, but then the beavers came and it flooded the area, so those bodies had to be moved. And then the townspeople, because the idea behind this town in part is at least that one of their big tourism drives, the only time of year they really do that is at Halloween. You know, they get really into Halloween, they go really hard on Halloween. So they convert the entire town into horror-themed habitats, and that's now what they use this area for, because there's just no one else here, basically. There's no other purpose for it. It's just sitting here becoming overgrown. So they put the lights in, they light it all up at night, and make it spooky. I feel good. Right, so there's our low-lying waterlands. I realised one thing. Yes, I really didn't have any ideas. I tried so hard to put text on these tombstones. I wanted to write, you know, stupid jokes. Like, here lies I can't think of any, but you know what I mean. Like, you get on Halloween sweets or chocolates or whatever, you get like little jokes, and it's always stupid people names who have died, and it's always puns. The only one in my head is Phil McCracken, and that's not one you'd find on a children's toy. But you know what I mean. Anyway, just building like a stony exterior. The path is going to stay the same for basically the entirety of the zoo. Inverted commas. It's barely a zoo, let's be honest. But I wanted the fence to change depending on the situation. Really just messing around with different things here, just trying to make them look a little bit different from each other, just so each grave stands out a little bit, just so it looks a little interesting. I just couldn't find a text. Even this tiny, tiny font that, I can't remember her name, or his name, I can't remember their name. The very talented person on Steam Workshop makes, I just couldn't get it to work, so. Just went for sort of elaborate designs more than anything else. That was my first experimentation with, maybe I could build a mausoleum, and I saw the lion head. I thought that would look really, I didn't know I'm using it, but it would look really cool as like a mausoleum. Anyways. No, this is when I should have done the talking. During the stone fence bit, nothing really happens. Oh, really, nothing happens. It's just me putting stone fence. You need this every now and again. This is when you clear your head and you're not really thinking. You know how they say where you're trying to creatively think through something, and the best way to do that is to go do something really mundane because your brain just kind of ticks away in the background? It's kind of the same idea. Oh, that's what I was talking about. There is someone on Twitter who I follow. Is it Poison for this that I'm on about? It might be. They are immensely talented at making like really natural looking Planet Zoo environments, and much more talented than I am at it, whatever. But I think one of the main reasons as well is I don't use elevation a lot. Now, this is meant to be like a flat sort of marshland, so it's okay, but I'm thinking back to my other exhibits, and it's quite a noticeable absence. I also think they're quite small, my exhibits, sometimes. So that's something I'm going to work on a little bit in the future. But feeling good about this one. I think this ends up looking really nice. You know, as nice as an abandoned church and graveyard can ever look, really. Got that kind of sickly green colour in the water. Just, yeah, we're going a little cheesy with it. Why not? And a lot of this build was just trying to figure out what is going to work. I quite like these Asian lamps, but with the torch inside. The fire does poke out the top a little bit, which is a little bit weird, but I think it's got a nice dramatic effect. It's good for a graveyard, really. And again, experimented with the green, because the green flame is a really cool idea, but again, it pulled focus from the church, which really stands out with those unnatural colours that I really wanted to emphasise, if possible. And here is where I discovered my love for the bramble. You'll see lots of brambles now throughout this entire playthrough, but I'd never really played with them until this exhibit right here, and I found them, and I was like, huh, this plant is awesome. So I used it everywhere. There's one particular shot in this exhibit, kind of to the left of the graveyard, where I did some really nice foliage work. It just looks so... I was really proud of myself on this one. And the next one. Oh, you just wait. Oh, one of the coolest things I've built in Planet Zoo. One of the coolest things anyone's built in Planet Zoo, quite frankly. Anyways, building up our little graveyard here. It will come together a little bit more at the end. I really wasn't leaning hard enough in the abandoned direct. There's my bramble love building. But it's always nice, I think, with a fence, even if it's not a proper zoo. The idea is it's meant to be a little bit of a zoo. You know, they are treating it as like a Halloween zoo-ish. I always like to have a plant behind or in front of the fence, just something to create like a double layer. And of course, I need to put trees absolutely bloody everywhere. I can't have sight lines going into the distance, not with how I build things. I still really want to build like a full zoo one day. Oh, so tempting, but so difficult to find the time. Life is so hard. Anywho. There's my moose. Still hadn't built the sign at that point, so the moose had to wait a little bit. I was getting a little bit, I think it was a little bit too bright was the problem at this point. I really wanted it to, I think I got rid of the ones in the windows or turned them down just a little bit. It was just a little bit too bright, and that was again dimming the effect of the light firing out, which was meant to be the main thing, you know, these lights pouring out of each hole, essentially. I decided to make the graveyard have a wall, because graveyards often have walls, and I thought it looks a little bit nicer. It's something more to work with as well. There I'm just lowering trees into the ground to completely block off the sight lines. Again, I always talk about this, but it's a real thing. If you block off sight lines with trees and shrubs and stuff like that, you can create the impression that your world goes on for much, much longer than it actually does. I've had people comment and say that they never used to do this, and they started doing it, and they changed their builds. So, I think I helped people with that one a little bit. Anywho, putting some detail on the walls. Pausing for no apparent reason. I think I have my music on the other monitor. I have to change it every now and again. And, yeah, just sticking on some... I think I got rid of a lot of that. I don't know, maybe I didn't. Yeah, there we go. You never know. Sometimes you just have to stick something on, hope for the best. If it works, it works. If it doesn't, it doesn't. What are you going to do? I built some toxic barrels in my Halloween little set, and it just... they didn't quite have the vibe. I'm going for a magic vibe. It's not meant to be a toxic vibe. But I thought what we'll do is we'll block this. That's not meant to be a cross. We'll block this up. You know, it's abandoned. It's boarded up. It's left to rot, essentially. And a couple of our education signs in there, which I still haven't built. I really need to get on this. I've kind of done half of it. I just want to build funny things, not education signs. And I was just trying to think about how to make these walls a little bit more interesting. So, you know, put a little bit on the ground, just, you know, decorate them up a little bit, just give them a little bit of life, just anything that makes them look less like just a flat Planet Zoo wall. It's really only 4 minutes left. That's crazy. Where's my mouse? Oh, seven. Okay, it's a long video. This was my longest build so far. Now the foliage can begin. So this is what I talked about in the last video. It was very important to find a combination of plants that I could fairly rigidly stick to. Every now and again, you might have something else popping out, but generally speaking, an area has the same plants, you know, spread out over a larger place. You don't want to be swapping between every single plant in your exhibit, and I tend to try to avoid that anyway, but this exhibit I very specifically went in thinking, right, I'm going to find a few plants that really work well together, and I'm going to go really hard on those few plants, basically. And that is, in the end, what I ended up doing. And it was brambles, it was the Guelda rosebush, it was the hawthorn, and the nettles. Those are the big four, really, in terms of ground foliage. The brambles in particular, as you can see, they're really good for just making things feel overgrown. And between those and the nettles, they've got really different colours and sort of different looks to them. I love that left side. I think it looks so good. Oh, my game crashed. There you go. I was clicking very quickly with my plant life. I've got to say, by the way, they added in Planet Zoo, they added a new button that you can tick. You actually can't see it on the right-hand side by default. It's a little bit further down. But it's a random rotation button for when you're pressing foliage. And it was, as soon as I read that, when I was looking at the upcoming pack and the upcoming update, that was the thing I was most excited about. It really does save a lot of time. Usually what you do is you click Z every time. You just rotate around. Kind of annoying. It saves a click every click. You know, it's half the amount of clicks. That's a lot of clicks. I would know, I'm a YouTuber. Clicks is all I care about. That's why I play Planet Zoo. Anyways, self-deprecating jokes over. So just brambles, nettles, everywhere, everywhere. And you get a feeling for how to use the brambles as well. There's actually a button I would really like as well, where you could select a few pieces of foliage and it would click randomly from them as well. That would be quite nice. Or like even just from the brambles or from the nettles, stuff like that, you know, and it would select a random one and rotate it randomly each time. I liked the idea here, you can see with the gold, whatever the hell, goldenrod, I think, at the back, and the pink ones, I forgot what they're called, I took a screenshot, I was proud. The pink ones at the front there. The idea was that someone's planted these plants at a grave to, you know, pay respects, as people do, and then over time, because the area's been abandoned and obviously they've moved on to other places, those plants have then begun to spread in that area, which I thought was quite a nice little idea. In a morbid sort of way. Let's assume by nice, I just mean cool. Or interesting, not necessarily, oh, isn't that sweet? I mean, it kind of is in a way. You know, you put down these plants to honour someone that you've lost or whatever, make the grave look nice, essentially. And that plant breathes new life into the area and spreads and becomes part of the environment. It's a nice idea. Anyways, there's a really specific thing I like to do, which is bramble number three, which is the big one, and then you surround that with a couple of bramble number ones, which is a smaller sort of one compared to number three, and then you sink bramble number two into the ground and put that all over the place nearby. Bramble number two is a very splayed out one. It kind of opens up to the top rather than curving in at the top. It's concave rather than convex. may have got that the wrong way round. I don't quite remember. Anyways, I mean, all I've done is put foliage down for the last like 5 minutes, so it was basically everywhere. The grass in the game looks fine, and the long grass in particular is actually really useful for making nice looking foliage areas. But my recommendation, if you want to build nice foliage, and even not even speaking from myself here, from me taking inspiration from other people on Planet Zoo who are immensely talented at this kind of thing, is just put foliage absolutely everywhere. Absolutely everywhere. No part of the ground should not be covered in foliage, unless it's like by a river, it's like rock texture or something like that. Just cover everything in foliage. It'll look better in the end. It does take a long time sometimes. I couldn't be bothered doing this backside, which you're barely going to get a glimpse of in the foliage again. So I was kind of duplicating it at this point and using the same foliage over and over again. But yeah, I was really proud of this. It's a weird sensation. Just staring at the screen now. Right, yeah, I was thinking about the mausoleum. I was Googling for reference images and I found like a nice little one. Again, I need that for my buildings. I don't have an architectural brain. I just never have. I wish I did. I wish I had a lovely architectural brain, but I just don't. I can't come up with building designs of my own accord. So, Googled one, found one, kind of went my own way in the end anyway, but it's nice to get a start, basically. And this is said start. It is in stone, which feels a little odd next to the church, but my justification was that this is simply more modern. You know, this was built sometime after the church. Again, abandoned over time when the area flooded. I really wanted the lion, it just wasn't going to work. Abandoned over time as the area flooded, but, you know, it was there maybe the first mayor of the town, or maybe the head... Okay, the last Viking to live in the area, and the Christians wanted to honour that Viking after everything they'd done, so they built a mausoleum in their style with what would be the more modern material at the time, which is more stone and stuff like that. Really like this, by the way, this concrete wall quoin, it's called. I've never used it before, but it like curves around the edge of the brick and makes it stand out a little bit. It's pretty cool. I just wanted to whiten up the sides, just to make it match the archway over the door, basically. And again, just a little interest of the building, a little bit more details. You're going to cover most of them up with ivy and stuff like that, but you get glimpses here and there, and it's important to give them a little bit of love. A little bit of love. Little bridge. Again, I have worries about the moose living here. The beavers did okay, they got around, but there's a lot of foliage in this habitat. We may have to move some stuff around. There's no moose in it yet. You're going to see that in the next part of the video. We'll add that in a little bit, but it is a concern, to be honest with you, how they're going to traverse this place. But as long as they can get to the front, which is where we'll put the things for the moose, the habitat items, so you can actually see them from the road, it should be okay. You'll notice it's a very low fence and stuff like that, but you can now make animals not escape. They will walk out of boundaries if it's a, you know, like a null barrier, they'll still walk out of it. But as far as I can tell, it means they'll never try to jump over or climb over a fence, basically. So you can fence in an animal with absolutely anything now, which is really useful. It's a great update. I love that the game is still guessing all this stuff. It's kind of crazy, actually. Planet Zoo has had a lot of support. I really hope we get another building pack, because I do enjoy those more than the animal packs. But that's just me personally. I know people are super hype about this NA pack. I've seen so many comments. Look at how good does that look, by the way. I've seen so many comments from people who are like thinking this is the best animal pack yet, and people are super excited about it, and all the animals in it are really good. You know, there's no Binturong in this pack, let's put it that way. Although the Binturong did get fixed. Let's be nice here. I'm sorry, Binturong people. Oh, I did change. I had a sign that I don't like that sign. I changed it. Anyways, right, that is the end. Moose build time-lapse VO, please. So, I'll just nip that to the end. But we're going to go see it. Okay, it's very muddy, isn't it? Ugh. Ugh. Why is it so muddy? God only knows. Anyways, we will hop in-game, and I'll give you the proper tour. See you in a sec. Right then, here we are on Beaver Bridge. Let's swing to the left and let's be very careful not to show the other side. There's the other side of the bridge, by the way. I don't think I showed that off properly last time at all. And then a slightly better look at the innards of the bridge. Oh, that's a little bit messy, actually. Might try and put some like brackets over the top of where the wood connects, but that's the inside of the bridge properly as well. And we're going to swing across. You'll see here the foliage system in place that I mentioned, and here we are at Moose Marsh. We'll of course return at nighttime in just a moment, but you get a much better feeling okay for the foliage work that I've done during the daytime. I think it looks really good. You didn't even see this in the video, but I've put some low-lying fog in there as well to really create that kind of feeling. You actually don't see it at nighttime at all. Funnily enough, I actually might prefer this whole thing in the day. But in there, as you can see, over there, that far side, there is our moose. I just brought those in. They can explore the entirety of the exhibit as well. At the moment, they're hanging around the back, but the food and the water is all up here at the front, so they should start to move forward, as you can see there. Let's just go observe from the inside for a little bit. We've got three females. We've got Zoe, we've got Zadie, we've got the male who is Dadie, and we've got Yvetia. And that is the recommended sort of grouping for the moose as well. One male, three females is their sort of maximum configuration. How you doing? I'm going to go check on the others because they've moved forward a little bit, which is cool. And now they've come back again. There's a shocking size difference between you two. So this is the mausoleum, as I mentioned, overgrown and left there. Let's see if we can mess around with the lighting a little bit, actually. Go. Look at that. Beautiful. And I'm going to swing a little bit around here. There's our, you know, misty lake, you know, covered in mildew and rotty bits, and it's all my words are failing me today, to say the least. There's the main pathway there, down towards the church, and if you look through the sort of the gap in the fence, I really like how that looks. You know, you can see this burning pathway down to the church, which sort of stands there, iridescent, not really, at night, iridescent amongst all the foliage. There's our little graveyard again, some little bit of mist hanging around, all overgrown, stuff like that. And this is I don't know why, but I really like the look of this area right here. This area on the left is kind of where I first started to experiment with the foliage. And it all kind of came together. I really like this habitat, I've got to say. I'm really proud of it. And I'm very rarely proud of my habitats. This one, I think it just came together in a really nice way. I think overgrown stuff is just something I'll always really enjoy doing. But yeah, there it is. That's basically the habitat. And we'll hang out with the meese, I should say, of course, a little bit more in a second. But yeah, it's a marshy area. They can explore the whole thing, which I shall show. Yeah, click you and click this. There we go. I'd like more of a pathway between here and here. But the point is that they can get into this whole area on the right-hand side as well. And they should do, because I think all the food... There's food there. And there's water there. I'm going to shift that a little bit further up the path to make sure it's accessible. But generally speaking, everything they need is over on this side. Now, let's check it out at night time, which is more so the point of this exhibit, it must be said. My bridge. Okay, we're going along. There's Moose Marsh, looking terrifying as planned. And oh yes, that's it. A little bit of a light on the mausoleum. I wanted you to notice it at nighttime, but you know, it couldn't dominate the landscape. It had to be quite subtle in the face of the church. Shifting along. The orange path leads up. A little bit of lights on the front gate as well, as you would expect. But really, the standout is the church. Glowing green, light pouring out from its orifices. This is all over the place. It's definitely not as boomf in your face as it was initially, because we've got so much stuff in front of it, so many trees, so much foliage, other lights as well, but just through nature of being bright green, I think it really stands out. It's got the look I want. You can see these light shafts here on the left and the right, and if we curve around, you can kind of see it coming out the front as well. And if we go inside, you can see, oh yeah, look in the right hand window. I forgot that I put him there. There's my little ghost. Yeah, just some lights in there. All the windows have been lit up individually, and then I've got a couple of little spotlights to light up that sort of back wall a little bit, so it looks like the inside is actually lit up, and then we're just using the spotlights to craft those more evocative light shapes. I left the graveyard relatively unlit as well. You need dark areas to go with the light to really make the whole thing stand out. And I think that looks really good. Is that too arrogant? I don't know. I think it looks fantastic. right, let's go back to... we can stay at nighttime for a little bit more. It is made for nighttime, this one. Much more than the last exhibit was. No, don't look over there. I have to keep hiding the other side of the screen. Can you please come? Right. Let's make it daytime so I can see what the hell is going on, basically. Where is someone at the door? Okay. Bear with me. I'm going to shout, and it's going to be very weird, but bear with me. Dad, I'm recording at the moment. I'll be done in a couple minutes. I think he heard that. Okay. Right, so let's find the male moose. Let's find a moose. Oh, there he is. Hello, buddy. Right, come on over here. Come over here. They're hanging around in the shadows at the moment. Oh, is he going to cross the bridge? Yeah, sort of. He's considering it. I can't view this exhibit from the other side. No, right, yeah, come here. None of you are playing how I want you to play. You will do as I command. All the moose are very cool, but the male is my favourite of the bunch, just because the antlers are just huge and powerful and really cool to look at, and it just makes him really stand out, you know? Look at them, massive. And there he is, and you want to view him from the outside? That's what he'd look like. Standing there. You know, it's kind of like this old abandoned church, and they've taken it for their own. They've taken over the area, and this is where they live now. And the townspeople are like, yeah, that's fine. We don't use it anymore, but we're going to sneak in every now and again and put some lights in. That's all. Yeah, chuffed. This is the kind of stuff I want to do more of. I kind of want to make like an entire zoo that's like an abandoned city. I know people have worked on similar things in the past. Maybe not an abandoned city, but an abandoned town? I don't know. Oh, but I want to build a skyscraper. I think that'd be really cool as well. Oh, maybe I'm going to build a city. We'll think about it. Can you turn around? Right, now, you've come to the right area, which is fantastic. I now need you to go over the other way so I can get you in a better light. There we go. Look at him. A noble beast, if there ever was one. Let's grab him a little bit at nighttime as well. Yes, that's exactly the kind of thing I wanted. And you catch the shadow of him walking in front of the church. Orange highlight. Oh, that glow. Lighting in this game is gorgeous. Look at that. Just go back and watch that again, how the light moves across the body, that backlit sort of effect. The only thing I'm confused about is why they're hanging out over here. There's no food over here. I don't think there's food over here. Yeah, they're spending all the time in this area. It's a bit odd. Oh, that looks amazing, though. I guess I can drink from this water. The water's clean. Well, if they want noms, they're going to have to go over there. What are you two up to? Making babies? Oh! I don't know if that's making babies or something much more dangerous. Well, it depends how you're making babies, I suppose. Okay. Oh, they are! Oh, sweet, we're gonna have a baby moose. Oh, that's cool. Do we have a baby beaver? No. Oh, yeah, that'd be awesome. Alright, we'll check that out in a few. We'll come back in a future video and we'll check out the baby moose. Oh, hey, finally, she's eating. Finally. There's a new watermelon item. Nom nom nom. Nom nom nom. Nom nom nom. Right, folks, that is it then. That is our second habitat. Our abandoned church, graveyard, mausoleum, overgrown and lost to time and to nature with a misty river sort of thing. In the next video, we're going to go over to this right-hand side. I'm going to get the slightest bit of a preview. There we go. That's the preview there. Slightest bit of a preview. Next video is an animal exhibit. It's the black-tailed prairie dog, but really it's about the exhibit around it. I put a lot of work in, as you shall see. But you'll see next video. So that will be on Saturday, just a couple of days. Come back and join me then. It's today Thursday. It's the 7th today. Yeah, so it'll be on Saturday. Thank you so much for joining me. I'll see you lovely folks then. If you like this video, please do throw me a like down below. It really does help. Comment as well. All that kind of jazz, you know. Let me know that you're enjoying Planet Zoo and that you want to see more of it. And that way we can keep going. Well, we're going to anyway because I've already done the videos. That's cool. Thanks for joining me. Cheers much as always. Bye-bye. We'll be right back.
reaching out.